My name is Kayla Oniwo. I'm a radio host, a media personality with Cool FM 96.9. Make some noise. It's my time to shine. Okay, thank you. All right, so let me tell you about our very special guest who's going to be speaking to us. His name is Dylan Jones, and he is an illustrious veteran of lifestyle journalism. He's seen it all when it comes to fashion and style, in the world of fashion and style. He's worked for over 3 decades, which is about 30 years. That's a pretty long time. And since 1999, Dylan has led GQ magazine to over 30 awards while winning nearly a dozen personal awards in the process, including being appointed an officer of the Order of the British Empire, and that was in 2013 by the Her Majesty, the Queen of England. So today he's going to be speaking to us. He's going to share his rich insights on the global trends shaping fashion and style. Let's put our hands together for that. Yeah, it's really hot. Sorry about that. That's why you have your cool GT fans. I see you moving from side to side. Okay, so I'm going to introduce the lady who's going to be moderating this. Please put your hands together for Lola Day. And while she takes her seat, please sit down. I'm going to now formally introduce Dylan Jones and have him on stage. Let's put our hands together. Warm welcome for Dylan Jones as he comes and takes his seat. Keep it going, guys. Come on. It's a great, great, great opportunity for all of us. Oh, you can see him. There he is. Let's keep the applause going. Thank you very much. All right, I'm going to be with you guys. So at the end of the discussion, if you have any questions for Dylan, I'll take the questions. So I'll let you know. So I'm just going to hang with you guys. They're pretty high here, so I'll just come down from here. Thank you.
Thank you, Kayla. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. Dylan, it's a pleasure to have you.
It's a pleasure to be here. No, it's great. And can I say, I'd like to say thanks to GT Bank for hosting this Fashion Weekend and also for making us feel so welcome. It's been a really fantastic couple of days. So thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Good. I have one complaint, though. It's not hot enough. Jesus wept. Okay.
Okay, so obviously, Dylan, you are one of the biggest names in British fashion. And we have a lot of questions for you. Let's start by understanding you've been the editor of GQ for over 17 years. How did it all start?
I was at the Sunday Times, the newspaper. And at this time in the 90s, back when God was a boy, there were lots of men's magazines in the UK, and they were sort of lifestyle titles. And the big change that's happened in the last 10 or 15 years has been the growth of menswear in a huge, huge way. Yeah. And GQ has always been a sort of a very, very fashionable magazine. The last 15 years or so have been a reflection of what's happened in the marketplace.
Absolutely. So how exactly would you say this market has changed?
Obviously, the biggest change has been the migration to digital. And yesterday I was at the fair out there, and I bumped into so many young designers all saying, what can we do to maximize our brand?
Absolutely.
And the thing is, it's there already.
Yes.
It's social media. It's not rocket science.
Yeah.
You know, a magazine has a finite number of editorial pages. A website is exponential.
Yes.
And so is Instagram. Yes. I just want to illustrate this. Many years ago, with Caroline Rush from the British Fashion Council, we set up London Collections Men, which is now London Fashion Week Men's. It was the first proper men's fashion week in London. This is 5 years ago now, and we set it up to reflect the fact that there'd been such a huge growth
Absolutely.
In menswear. And what we did, we encouraged lots of big British brands who'd previously showed in Milan and Paris and New York to come back and show in London, as well as inviting other international designers. But the thing that I want to mention about social media is that Tom Ford, one of the biggest fashion designers in the world, he would have small presentations where every half an hour, every 45 minutes, he would invite 20 or 30 journalists into his studio and he would talk them through the collection.
Yes.
And for seasons, he banned photography. But then, like a lot of people, he realized and understood the power of Instagram. And so that season, everyone who came in that day, every 45 minutes, all those journalists, they're all taking pictures. And the amount of free publicity and the free media and the free marketing and the free advertising that he got was in seven figures.
Wow.
It's his studio.
Yeah.
Zero cost. His clothes.
Yes.
Zero cost. He's making the clothes anyway.
Yes.
The models probably did it for free because it's Tom Ford.
Yes.
Zero cost.
Yes.
Whereas the entry level cost of a sort of bog standard fashion show is easily $75,000.
Yeah.
So it just makes complete sense.
Absolutely. I mean,
interrupt me anytime you like, because I could talk for hours.
So obviously, digital and social have impacted the fashion industry in a huge way. What about for print publications? People say that print is dead. What do you have to say about that?
Well, this is going in two directions. I think that now, you look at a magazine like ours, we run like a newspaper. So every day at 10 o'clock, we have an editorial meeting where we're planning what we're putting up on the website that day. We're planning what we're doing on social. We're planning what everyone else in the office is doing that day in terms of news gathering, fashion shoots, reportage. And all of that information comes in and it's chopped up and fed out through all our different channels.
Yes.
And yes, print is really challenged. But the great thing is that these days you have so many other opportunities.
Yes.
And I think there are a lot of people in our industry, in journalism, running around like headless chickens, saying that the world's over. It's not over, it's just changed.
Yes.
You know, it's like the Industrial Revolution. There has been a huge change. And unless you cope with that, you'll die. I mean, there will be winners and losers.
Yes.
Of course there will.
Yes.
But the huge growth for us, and the huge growth for lots of magazines like ourselves, like Vogue or Vanity Fair, is in video. Because I look at my daughters, and they only consume on this. They don't have laptops, they don't watch television, they don't read magazines, they don't read newspapers. Everything's on this. And video, that's what they watch. And there's such a huge surge in video. What it comes down to is quality.
Yes.
And the thing is, everyone with a mobile telephone now thinks they're a journalist.
Yes.
They think they somehow are media. And in some respects, they are media, but it doesn't mean they're any good. Mm-hmm. And actually, it comes down to quality, whether you're writing an article, taking a picture, making a video.
Yes.
It all comes down to quality.
Yes.
But you say print is dead. I mean, I was talking yesterday to a very nice woman who's produced this magazine. I think as a one-off for Fashion Week, and now she's going into production next spring. This magazine has been around for a while. In fact, it's done a huge feature on Men's Fashion Week in London. Very, very good. Very, very good. And these are artisanal, bespoke publications.
Yes.
But they're working. And if you come to London, and you go to Soho, you look in a lot of the newsagents, or you go to Selfridges, you will see dozens and dozens and dozens of fashion magazines, new fashion magazines that have been born in the last two or three years. Mm-hmm. And they've all got fantastic photography, they've all got great journalism, they're all printed on beautiful paper. They might only be selling 5, 10, 15,000 copies, but it doesn't matter, it's a genuine cottage industry.
Okay. Fantastic. And let's talk a little bit about the editorial content of GQ. In terms of your covers, you've had some of the most iconic covers. Have you in any way seen some sort of a migration in terms of having men on your covers and having women on your covers. And how would you say, in terms of how your audience has evolved, how this has affected how you've chosen to sort of the path you've chosen for your editorial content?
Well, you're right. 15, 20 years ago, it was almost impossible to put a man on the cover of a magazine, because there was such an orthodoxy in the UK for having sexy girls on the cover of the magazine. There was a huge rise in what became known as lads mags, Maxim, FHM, Loaded, all these things. And they were incredibly successful. But their USP was sex, basically, which is a very reductive idea, essentially. And what none of these publishers could cope to realize is that they experience huge growth. I mean, absolutely huge growth patterns. But eventually you taper off and you start to dip. Editors panic, publishers panic. And as your USP is sex, then the only way to amplify that is becoming sexier. Yeah. And there's only a certain direction you can go in that direction before you turn into something quite tawdry.
Yeah.
So the editorial became less interesting. And also that coincided with the rise of the internet, which is, if you want that kind of material, you'd find it on the internet, I assume. So, but that allowed magazines like ourselves, which had always occupied the sort of upper end of the market, if you will, to focus on what we really wanted to do, which was put fantastic looking guys on our cover. You know, whether it's George Clooney or Tiny Temper or Brad Pitt or David Beckham, whoever.
Yeah, fantastic.
I could have just said women then, men now, couldn't I? Would have been a lot shorter.
Okay, so now, obviously, the world has gone digital, like you've said. And with that has been the emergence of e-commerce, which is huge now, both in the Western part of the world and growing more so now in developing markets. How would you say this has impacted journalism, but even beyond that, the fashion industry?
E-commerce?
Yes.
I think it's logical, because, and actually the two worlds are moving very, very close together. Because if you look at e-commerce sites, you look at any transactional website, what they're interested in is content.
Yes.
Because if someone's coming to your digital shop and they're looking at things to buy, they want to be flattered with editorial. So there's a huge growth in that area. But also, if you look at a lot of editorial products, like ourselves, like Vogue, we are also moving into e-commerce, because if you look at something in a magazine or on a website or on a telephone and you like it, you want to buy it.
Of course.
So what we've done previously is allowed those people to go away, to go somewhere else, to buy their clothes from somewhere else. Yeah. But actually it makes much more sense if we're featuring an incredibly expensive and extravagant fashion collection that we've spend a lot of money shooting, that you should be able to press those buttons and be able to buy it. So I see that the two worlds converging almost.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit now about luxury. What's the world of luxury like these days? I mean, with the internet, people believe that the internet has democratized the world, and fashion that was traditionally very exclusive, people are now able to access online. They're able to see lookbooks. They're able to digest this as content. What's happening in the world of luxury, and how does this all fit in?
Thank you. I think there's two things here. I think that you still see a lot of people in the luxury goods industry trying to put a velvet rope around the internet because they don't understand it. It's too egalitarian, it's too democratic, too democratic. It scares them. And actually, the great thing about digital is that it opens up everything to everybody. You might not necessarily be able to afford it, but you can enter that world. So I think that the successful brands that are moving forward in this world completely get digital, and they completely understand that you have to engage with your customer.
Yes.
And that you have to have a genuine relationship. Because you might be expensive, you might be exclusive, you might be whatever, but unless you have a relationship, you become disenfranchised from, right. from the experience. I think the other thing is that, I mean, I was talking to a lot of people at the Fashion Week fair yesterday about this. It's about the exclusive nature of what you do. Because back in the 80s, the prefix of choice was designer. So you had designer clothes, you had designer television, designer cars, designer mineral water. Everything was designer something. Then it became luxury. You had luxury bath soap, yes. luxury sofas, luxury yes. airlines, luxury hotels. And now the prefix of choice is bespoke, made to measure.
Yes.
That's what people want. They want yes. a unique experience. Yes. And whether that's a pair of shoes, whether it's a jacket, a holiday, or even yes. your sexuality. These days, you can pretty much choose anything.
Yeah.
And that's what people want. They want choice.
That's amazing. With that in mind, how would you say, if I went to Savile Row 15 years ago, and I went to Savile Row today, what has changed? How has this sort of impacted the way that people do business in terms of providing a bespoke service, creating a luxury brand, sustaining a luxury brand? Have businesses sort of evolved?
I mean, Savile Row is a very, very interesting example. Because 15 years ago, they probably wouldn't have wanted your business. I mean, that's a terrible thing. Savile Row, fantastic institution, but it was a very narrow world.
Yeah.
And it put a lot of people off. Nowadays, lots of women have made-to-measure suits, bespoke suits, but the guys that were running the Savile Row tailors 15, 20, 25 years ago, probably wouldn't have understood that. Plus, it was a very class-based thing. It was to do with heritage, education, money, all that's gone. And if you look at Savile Row now, which is still the best example of tailoring, I think, in the world, I know you have some amazing tailors here, there are some amazing tailors in Milan, lots of places in the world, but I happen to think that the London ones are best. But if you look at the clientele, they're completely different. They're young guys, they're 25-year-old guys. Not everything costs a lot of money because you can go in at various different entry levels. Many years ago, I had a covert coat made by a Savile Row tailor. And at the time, I went into the store and there were probably six or seven people working there, and they all looked like dead people. You know, they were all like 100 years old, dribbling, and, you know, it was funny. It was a great experience, but it felt like a very old-fashioned experience. And then a couple of years ago, I took the coat back, which is about 15 years after it had been made, which shows you how well it was made. And I took it back for some alterations. And the place had 40 people in the cutting room. And it was alive, it was vivacious, and there was a real sense of urgency, because Savile Row is now, as I say, an exemplar of how fashion has changed. Fashion is democratic.
Yes. Can we talk a little bit about global fashion now? In terms of, so we obviously know you have London, you have New York, you have Milan, you have Tokyo. How would you say that menswear fashion, particularly in London, how does it stand out as compared to what you see happening in other international markets? And where are the opportunities? What are the trends that are sort of happening in other parts of the world?
Well, if you look at menswear in particular, menswear is really in the ascendancy. Menswear is vertical at the moment. And I think a lot of that is generational, because guys like shopping now. You know, guys are cool. They aspire to being cool. It's no longer considered to be effeminate. And I think in a lot of countries, it was. I mean, you have a great tradition of men dressing in a very exotic way in your country. And to a certain extent, we do too. But it wasn't always that way. I think men are more sophisticated now. They shop more like women. But they like fashion. But about, I suppose, 8 or 9 years ago, when the economic crash happened, menswear kept growing. All these women's wear brands around the world took such a hammering because they're great behemoths. They're huge, huge companies, which with huge P&Ls. And menswear has always come from a much smaller base, but it sort of gradually grew and grew and grew. So not only was there a renewed interest in fashion from a generational point of view, not only was there genuine economic growth, but also, as you say, there were more centres around the world. I mean, when we launched Men's Fashion Week in London 5 years ago, one of the most important things that we wanted to do, as well as celebrating British designers, was to encourage designers from all around the world. And it wasn't just from France and Italy and the United States. There's a hell of a lot from Asia, and also from Africa too. I mean, there's one brand here, Orange Culture. They showed at our first Men's Week, and they have a fantastic Instagram account. They do some beautiful clothes, but that's an example of how a small brand can really have cut through, because they've chosen London as an international platform, and they're exploiting digital. But more importantly, the design is really, really good. You have to be good.
Yeah. If you you're have not good, to be good.
That's it.
So that leads me to my next question. Would you say that there's any disruption happening right now within fashion? I mean, we've talked about digital, we've talked about globalization, but in particular, would you point to any specific, is there anything specifically that's happening that's disrupting the industry?
I think the most disruptive thing that's happening in our industry at the moment is to do with fashion weeks. And as Caroline touched on yesterday, Burberry, who are one of the biggest brands in the world, big British brand, took a huge step this year by going direct to consumer, i.e. they showed their clothes on the catwalk, and the minute they came off the catwalk, they were available to buy online and in their stores. That's a seismic change in our industry. So you have that going on. You have people thinking, because of digital, because of the fact that if you go to a fashion show and you post a picture for millions of people to see, that can now be seen, but you previously couldn't buy it for 6 months. They've made that instantaneous. So you have that going on. You also have brands like Gucci, again, one of the biggest brands in the world, who in the last 9 to 12 months have gone through a real cultural renaissance. They've decided to show their men's and women's together in one fashion show. Now, that might not seem like it's the biggest thing in the world, but in the industry, that's huge. So you have that going on. You have Burberry going direct to consumer. You have lots of brands like Louis Vuitton doing extravagant, or Dior doing extravagant shows in Hawaii or Rio or Havana, just to create interest. And then you have other brands like Dolce & Gabbana. And I think this is a really interesting example. And I think this is an example that can be copied by many people, regardless of what level you're at, or in indeed what kind of fashion you're producing, or indeed in what territory. After the season's fashion shows, they pick an exotic location, Naples, for instance. They have a huge fashion show. Friday night it's women's, Saturday night it's men's. They invite some celebrities to give it a bit of fizz, and then they invite 500 of their best customers. And so the best, these customers, they get champagne, they get dinners, they get access to celebrities, they see these amazing fashion shows. It's all very inclusive, but there's an understanding that you're going to buy.
Yes.
And if you don't buy, you won't be invited back. But that's brilliant, because all of us are in we're all in the business of shortening the distance from a pair of trousers or a pair of heels or a dress to a consumer. Whether we are manufacturers, designers, media, all we're trying to do is shorten that distance. And that's a brilliant way of doing it.
With that in mind, what would you say is what's your ultimate vision for London Collections Men?
I suppose the ultimate vision is to make it really, really, really culturally important, because anyone can design a bad pair of trousers. Anyone can have a fashion show if they find enough money. The important thing is to keep the quality up. And it's meant to be a platform for the younger designers who perhaps didn't get the bandwidth or the airtime previously. It's meant to be a platform for big British brands, but also, ultimately, I suppose, I think what we all want for Men's Fashion Week in London is for it to be an international platform. So whether you're from Milan, whether you're from Swansea, whether you're from New York, or whether you're from Lagos, that London is a place that welcomes great talent.
Absolutely.
That's what we want.
Yes. Okay, so now obviously we're here in sunny Lagos, Nigeria for GT Bank Fashion Weekend. What's the weekend been like for you, and what's your impression of this event?
Yeah, it's been brilliant. I mean, the thing is, I always take things at face value, and I got invited out here by Baba, a guy I've known for ages, and you kind of think that'll be fun, but I really had no idea. I mean, I've been to East Africa a lot. I've been to South Africa and North Africa. I've never been to West Africa. Had a fantastic time. The people have been amazingly nice. We've had a very good chaperone who won't let us go anywhere. She's really tough. I wanted to go off the island. She said, you're not allowed to go off the island. But in all seriousness, the event that we've been at the last 2 days, it's no different from an event in London. It's vibrant. There's a lot going on. And people are talking to each other. And I gather that people are doing good business, which again is why we're all here. But it's been good. And also, I think from my point of view, what's interesting for me is that there are quite a lot of menswear designers here, which I didn't really expect. And that shows you again that menswear is really in the ascendancy.
Absolutely.
At the moment. So all you fashion designers who are doing womenswear, stop immediately and start doing menswear. Okay? There we go. Good.
So what's your advice for the Nigerian menswear designer who is trying to grow his brand, who is looking to hopefully one day become a global brand, access an international audience? What advice would you give?
Well, two things. Have very, very good friends, because if your friends are good, they'll tell you that you can't design clothes, and then you can stop it and go on and do something else. But secondly, you have to use digital. I mean, I have lost count of the number of people, whether they're fashion designers or artists or musicians or furniture designers, that I found through Instagram. It sounds like a trite thing to say, but Instagram's only about 5 or 6 years old, but it's completely revolutionized everything. It's about using digital smartly, because if you're good and you curate what you produce very, very well, and you understand the logistics of the medium, and you're good, there's absolutely no reason why you can't get traction from that. Again, it's limitless. Magazines, newspapers, they're all finite because we have a finite number of editorial pages. But I think digital media, I mean, I wish I owned some digital media, but I don't. But it's been fantastic, and it's a great boon for designers, because it just means you can get your message out there to everybody.
Fantastic. Now, my last two questions.
These aren't good, I can tell. When anyone ever says these are the last two questions, these are the questions you don't want to answer.
Who is the coolest Londoner you know?
Well, probably Tiny Temper. He's a great ambassador for London menswear. He's told me a lot about Nigeria. Some things I couldn't repeat up here, actually. But he's great, and he's not only is a really sharp dresser, he understands the business. He understands how to make it work. He's launching his first proper menswear collection in London in January with us, which we're completely thrilled about. But he's been a great ambassador, a great supporter, and we've tried to give that enthusiasm and support back, and I'd say it would have to be Tiny.
We like Tiny.
Good. don't tell him I said that, because it'll go to his head.
Your secret's safe with us. Tell us about your personal style. What is Dylan Jones's personal style?
Right now, I wish I was wearing a bathing suit. occasionally, a blogger will come up and ask me that question when we're just about to go into Men's Fashion Week. But to be honest with you, I get up in the morning and I put a blue suit on. It's as simple as that. Sorry to be so boring, but it's a shirt and a blue suit.
Fantastic.
I mean, with underwear and everything else, but it's a blue suit, you know.
Okay, fantastic. Now we're going to take some questions from the audience. Kayla?
There's definitely
okay.
One.
All right.
You have some questions.
Now, can I just say, the acoustics in here, if you're wearing one of these, is awful. I actually can't hear a thing, so you may have to paraphrase for me.
Okay, I will. So,
There's definitely a hand there. I can see a hand.
Hi, Dylan.
Hello.
Okay, my name is Adewale Adigbaye. I run Kijikwa Africa. It's a men's, it's a gentleman's brand. And first of all, I want to say that I've enjoyed a lot of your value-adding words since we started. And I want to say that the question is, what's your footwear size? Because you said in the past, it was firstly people longing for designers, and secondly, it became luxury, and now it's bespoke. And I do fantastic bespoke pieces for men. So you're going to have one right now from Kijikwa Africa. So what's your size? That's my question. What's your shoe size? What's your shoe size?
The question is...
I'm getting into a lot of noise over here. I think you were being nice. I'm not sure, but I think you were.
It is nice. Fantastic masterpieces. Can you hear me?
His question was, what's your shoe size?
What's your shoe
size?
Nine and a half.
9.5/10.
You just want one for yourself right now. Right here. Thanks for coming, Dylan.
Hi, Dylan.
Hello.
My name is Amina. I'm a blogger, new fashion blogger. And the name of my blog is Mad Mediations. But I have been reading GQ. I know I'm female, but I've been reading GQ for a very long time. And some of the most interesting articles I've read on GQ. So I was wondering, as a blogger and somebody who writes about a variety of things, what does it take to be a contributing writer? What does it take if I want to contribute as a writer to
what does
GQ,
it take?
To be a contributing writer to GQ?
The question...
Send me an email. I mean, the most disappointing thing these days is that we get very, very few unsolicited offers of work. It's the weirdest thing, and I think it's a millennial thing, I'm not sure, but what any industry needs is youth, and what our industry needs is young people with talent coming to us, because while we have a very good network at finding people, it's not that good. And what we actually need is people to send things into us. So I'm forever encouraging people to send me personal emails, because that's the way you get a connection with people, and that's the way you find out if someone's good. And also, I mean, I've always said this to the interns and the work experience people that come in to the office. And I always say that if you're trying to get a job somewhere, always find out who the most senior person is. Because they'll almost undoubtedly respond, because they'll feel guilty. But seriously, you'll send it to someone else and it'll get pushed around and given to he, da, 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 da. You always go to the most senior person.
And my second question...
I hope that answered your question. I'm sorry, I can't hear a thing.
Oh, yeah. My second question is, I have this month's edition of GQ, and I was wondering if you'd autograph page 31 for me.
What's she saying?
I have this month's this month's edition of GQ, and I was wondering if you'd autograph page 31.
She'd like an autograph on the March edition of GQ magazine.
Yeah.
No, November, this month.
All right, can I have, okay, take it, let her go, take her to the front.
Is the answer yes? Yeah.
Yeah, Dylan, I think it's nice you stay up here and...
Okay, that's better, yeah. I can hear you now.
You can hear better
the whole thing up here. Hello.
I have this month's edition of GQ, and I was wondering if you'd autograph page 31.
Oh my goodness, it'd be an absolute pleasure. God.
A round of applause, guys. She's got a personalized autograph.
Okay, of course, it'd be an absolute pleasure.
31.
So we're looking for page 31, right?
Right.
Wow, it's going to take some time.
Find here. It, we can queue up the next question.
Is that
yeah,
the one?
We have our next question coming.
Great. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed.
All right.
Thank you, Dylan.
Pleasure.
Good afternoon, Dylan. My name is Dieko.
Hello.
Okay, over time, it's been easy for men to influence the women fashion, but it's always been difficult for women to actually influence the men fashion. Right when I went into fashion, I was interested in women fashion, but over time, I got more interested in the men's part. But trying to get men to do what you actually, the designs you have is actually difficult, trying to convince them. But when you convince them, they try to stick back that I don't have an issue with. But what advice do you have for a woman trying to influence the women, the men's fashion, trying to go into a menswear and trying to have a label in such collections?
Well, I think men shop in a, even though they're more sophisticated consumers now, I think they shop in a different way because I think women tend to, I think, buy more seasonally, so they'll buy something because it's new, whereas a man tends to buy something because he hasn't got one. So if it's a pair of brown shoes, I haven't got a pair of brown shoes, so I'll buy a pair of brown shoes. And I think they box tick. I think I do. You sort of, you know, I haven't got one of these, for instance. And Barbara says he's going to give me one. So, I think you have to pique men's interest because they're less obsessed about things that are seasonal and more interested in particular pockets of their wardrobe. And also, I think they're interested in things that have a perceived value, something that's going to last. I mean, that sounds like a trite thing to say, but I think men really do buy for investment purposes as much as anything else.
Thank you, Dylan.
There's a lady down here. Hello.
Yeah, Dylan.
Wow. Hello.
Okay, my name is Kachif. I do bespoke for men, and what I do is we come to a comfort zone to take your measurement and then return. But the thing is, I think the new trend now, even international brands like Tom Ford and so on, they have experience centers. They have places that they want people to come. Apart from the clothing, they want to give them the champagne, talk to them, and on. So I think that's a new thing right now, and although it's quite expensive. But then I think, is there any way that we, the normal Nigerians, that goes to your customer's office or his house, is it possible for us to inculcate what people do abroad? Like, for example, you're not allowed to leave the island. So we can bring the mainland to you. So the thing is, I just want to know, if is it luxurious for people to come to your house to do bespoke for you? Yeah.
I think the short answer is yes, because people want an experience. And I think that as more people shop online, that if you have a retail offer, whether that's in your house, in your studio, in your shop, or something that you're prepared to offer by visiting someone else, that's a genuine experience. And I think if you can make that an enjoyable, immersive, rich experience, that will pay dividends. Because even though people have got very used to buying things online, it's a very transactional process. There isn't a lot of love involved. That's not to say there's anything wrong with it, but I think people do enjoy the process of visiting someone, talking to someone, drinking a lot of champagne, etc., etc., etc. So I think that it's all in how you do what you do. And if you are going or you're attracting people, you have to make the experience a rich and enjoyable one.
All right, thank you. We still have time for about three more questions. You have a mic over there? Okay, please go ahead.
Okay, good afternoon.
Hello.
My name is Nike Adegbite. I'm an entrepreneur and I also have a fashion show myself. I want to ask, I know the fashion as we know it in Africa, the standard is being set by people like Tom Ford. I want you to advise fashion entrepreneurs, especially made designers right here, even females, how can they distinguish their own pieces, you know, and be original? Why can they, because you said you have a fashion week that you would like them to come to. But in my opinion, I think their designs are sort of going to blend in. You know, they are going to look like what you've seen before. How can they infuse our own culture and fabrics, you know, into what they do and still be internationally acceptable? Then I want to ask again, like what the gentleman over there, what he's wearing, do you think non-Africans are ready for those kind of pieces? Because you rarely see them, you know, during your shows, you see the regular suit, you see the dresses, you know, nothing really so, you know, unique. Do you think right now, African fashion designers need to start exporting fashion pieces that are original, because that's going to add color, you know, and flavor to your shows? I really want you to give that kind of advice and all that.
I think that it's obviously there are huge complications, but I think that it comes down to originality and a genuine understanding of culture. And I think that the very worst design is design that copies something else, whether it's African, American, English, whatever it is. And I think that if something has a real worth and a real originality, and the people involved in producing it are actually talented, then I think that you stand a very, very good chance of infiltrating the culture. But it comes down to real creativity. And I think, I mean, I'm not blind to the problems of distribution and media, but I think that if you're good at what you do, then that's half the battle.
Hi, Dylan.
Hello.
My name is Honey Ogundeyi, and I run an online retailer in Nigeria. It's called Fashpa. And I wanted to ask a question about the marriage between content and commerce. So one of the things we do at Fashpa is to sort of marry creating exciting and aspirational content with the commerce. And I wanted to see, what was your experience at GQ, and how are you seeing sort of your content reflecting with retailers, especially designer brand? And then the second point was, my husband is a huge GQ collector. He's been buying it since he was 16, and I have to bring it back for him every time I travel. So I just wanted to make him slightly jealous as well by saying that.
I think that your point is probably the most important point of the entire things that we talked about today, because I always look at I take a lot of guidance from the way that media is changing through my daughters, who are 16 and 18. And because they consume everything through a telephone, those old ideas of provenance, of church and state, commercial, editorial, they've evaporated. And actually, if they look at a great piece of content on their phone, they don't really, well, they don't know, but they also don't really care who's paid for it. They don't know if Condé Nast or GQ has paid for it, whether GT Bank has paid for it, whether Louis Vuitton has paid for it, and it actually doesn't matter. The important thing for them is, do I like it? Can I share it? And can my father buy it for me? But it's that mixture of art and commerce, if you will, that I think is one of the most exciting changes in our industry, because it's a different form of content. But it comes down to quality again. If it's bad sponsorship, if you're just sticking a logo on something and saying we own this now, no one's going to buy into that, because you're not actually producing anything different. But actually, genuine content that's produced by editorial and commercial can have great value. We at GQ are just doing a huge global piece of business for Gucci right now, And it's an international ad campaign which will be completely global, and they've come to us because they like our editorial. And we don't have any qualms about getting into bed with Gucci because they're a fantastic brand, and there's obviously a commercial imperative. I think it only goes wrong when you're trying to mix apples and pears, and when you're basically trying to force a sponsor onto an editorial project that has no validity at all. But if the two brands are compatible, it's not an issue at all.
Hello, Dillian.
Hello.
My name is Jennifer Rene. I have a brand called Victoria Grace Brand. I quit my day job 7 weeks ago. I was in trade and commerce.
Wow.
A couple of years before then, I worked for Condé Nast under Stephen Quinn for Vogue magazine.
Great.
I did PR in fashion as well before I went back into trade and commerce. And now I'm back in fashion. I put a show on in London last year. I got interest from a buyer from the US for 200 stores worldwide. I was in shock because it was a hobby at that time. Came back to Nigeria, realized that I can't produce that. I can't find the fabrics. I can't find so many things, and it's taken me a whole year to try and put the pieces together. That's why I quit my job. One of the missing dots as well that I've identified that I haven't even approached is there a possibility that the leading magazines can run a global campaign or show on people like us that have served the fashion industry, are trying to do well both for this country using raw materials here, and you can showcase us, someone like me, in your magazine or...
Congratulations for doing what you've done. I think two things. Obviously, our Men's Week is an opportunity for designers from anywhere in the world to come and show, and as I say, we have had some Nigerian designers come and show. But also, I think that if you produce collateral, if you produce great assets, we can host them on our website. And at the moment, I speak to a lot of clients. Like, I was speaking to BMW the other day. I said, how many films do you make a year? And they probably manufacture 120 films a year, most of which are never seen by anybody. They say, you come to us early, and we'll go an hour before you go live, a day or a week or something. You slightly recut it, and that's a zero-sum game. It's brilliant for them, and it's brilliant for us. But if you produce a great video or some great pictures, give them to us, and we'll host them on our website. Great for me, great for you.
Hi, Dillian.
Hello.
My name is Abubakar Tafabli. I met you at the LCM in London, and I got to take a picture with you. I've been a big fan of yours, and I'm sitting with another editor of a magazine here. Our major challenge is that with international brands, you're able to attract advertising with some of the covers you've had. If you've got Will Smith on your cover, you get certain advertising. If you've got famous people. But back home here in Nigeria, it doesn't work that way. And I just wanted to find out how to attract advertising, because it's a challenge for a lot of Nigerian publications.
You need to probably change what you're doing. And if I go back to what I was saying earlier about the huge growth in print titles, they are very, very, very specific. There's an independent magazine shop in London called Mag Culture. They've got a great website, great Instagram feed, and they are in the business of amplifying and publicizing independent magazines. But there are magazines there. There's a Swedish magazine, which is all about wood, right? About wood. It's about, you know, things made of wood, types of wood, the intricacies of wood. I mean, it sounds like it's comical, but it's not. It's a beautiful magazine printed on beautiful paper. That's full of fashion advertising, because those fashion advertisers know that trendy magazine is going to appeal to a particular kind of person. I think the obvious thing is to do is to possibly look at what you're doing and say to yourself, how original am I really being? Am I just trying to copy someone else? Because I'm not saying you are, but I think a lot of advertisers might think, well, why do I need this? Because it's just doing what someone else is doing, but they don't have the budget to do it in the way that other people are doing it. So maybe it's a magazine that's all about sunglasses, or it's a magazine that's all about cheese. I don't know. But I mean, it helps, again, to be specific and to be bespoke.
All right. Thank you very much. Please, a round of applause for Dillian.
Thank you
so much.
Hey, what's up, guys? They call me DJ Spinner, a.k.a. The Cap. You enjoyed the video you just watched? Please subscribe and Danny TV. just click below and subscribe and you can watch more amazing videos.